Buongiorno, io prima di iniziare la seduta vera e propria vorrei invitare tutta la Commissione a unirsi con me nella stanza della Commissione, in modo che discutiamo un paio di cose e poi rientriamo nella stanza dove sono i candidati.
Viviana, sei una fotomodella?
Allora, come la facciamo? Facevamo alfabetico, matricola, tu eri sempre l'ultimo.
Ormai era assegnato.
Comunque abbiamo fatto e siamo pronti per la discussione. Now we speak in English and we are ready to discuss this exam for graduation, final graduation in Industrial Engineering. And I would like just to give some instruction how to discuss this exam, which is a little bit different from previous one. We will start in alphabetical order, but with the only exception of Pagliara. Pagliara will be shipped as a request from the tutor at the end of this section. And will be then Margherita, Cece, Lento, Mariani, Mancuso, Salvi and Pagliara. This will be the order, so the candidate will prepare in this order that I just said, and the candidate has 20 minutes for discussion. Please keep your time, which is also part of the evaluation of this commission, the being on time, and then there will be a question asking, and this at the end of the section, the overall section, the commission will decide and then back to you for the final vote.
Si principium Zapartonsky. The human eye is the external sense organ of the visual apparatus and it is responsible for rotating information on the surrounding environment through the light.
This is the included in the application, so thank you very much. Thank you.
Any other question? Otherwise, I do have a curiosity. When you your attempt in using this as a stress sensor, you know, it will be good to have an idea what is the highest resolution that you can measure the stress. You know, because if you use a confocal microscope, you are limited in the penetration depth,
yes,
and also the distance where you can measure this. Or do you have any other way to measure the intensity of fluorescence, not to use a microscope or any other device that they will be limited in the extension or the penetration?
For the moment, we are only to understand that the bioluminescence related to the LP algae, but in the device selected, because we also have designed this device. But of course, this will be the preliminary studies for the use of more complex geometry and also other microscopes. We are only in the first part, so the design of the device was essentially designed essentially for this study. So.
Very good. Viviana, again, congratulations, and if you allow us, we will move to the next candidate, which is Marcello Salvi. Marcello Salvi has done a thesis under the supervision of Davide Cacchiarelli, and I invite Marcello to take the floor and get the chance to present his work. Marcello, are you there?
Yes, I'm here. I'm just uploading the PowerPoint.
Okay.
Can you see me?
All right. Okay. Yes.
Perfect.
We do.
Thank you for your kind introduction. I'm here today to present the result of my 9-month internship in Professor Chiacchiarelli's lab at the Teleton Institute of Genetics and Medicine. And my thesis title is Cloud Computing for Genomics and Personalized Medicine, a COVID-19 Application. This is the agenda for today. I will start briefly describing what is genomics and which are the technology that make genomics the branch of science that more than other produce big data. Then I will propose cloud computing as a reliable solution in order to manage, process and storage this huge amount of data. Third, I will present you my bioinformatic pipeline that I developed in the last month in order to detect SARS-CoV-2 virus. And finally, I'll give you some future perspective about which can be the future of genomics and digital technology for personalized medicine. So, let's start. Genomics is the science that studies whole genomes of organisms, where rich genomes is the complete set of DNA into the organism, that is usually condensated into chromosomes that express different genes that is composed by a sequence of the four different nucleotides. In order to have an idea on the amount of data that we deal, let's consider that each cell has a DNA molecules of 3 billion bases. And if I want to write out this information on a book, I will need more than 1,000 books. Each of them must have 2,000 pages. So, which is the ability that during the past decades we reached a huge ability to read genomes using next generation sequencing. That is a real disruptive technology that starting from DNA sample, it is possible, it uses DNA fragments of less than 100 base pair, and using the sequencer, it excited with different wavelength. And the result of the sequencing is a Bell-Cole image like the one in this picture, which each nucleotide has a different color. And then the first step for a bioinformatician is to translate this image into a sequence of char that are called reads. I will just say NGS is a really disruptive technology, and if we consider the graph on the left, that is the DNA sequencing cost over the time, we can see that in 2001, when the sequencing of one genome cost more than 100 million, while thanks to the introduction of next generation sequencing, we had a drop in cost even more than the prediction of Moore's law. And it arrived into 2014 to cost almost $1,000 for each sequencing. On the other hand, the drop in cost is accomplished with a dramatic increase of data. Let's consider that nowadays the cumulative, the worldwide annual sequence capacity is at petascale, that means 1000 terabytes, and in the next 5 years it will achieve hectabyte, that is 1000 petabyte scale. In this way, during my internship, I have to deal on how to face and how to treat this huge amount of data. And the solution that I'm going to propose you is cloud computing. That using a sentence from Mark Benioff, that is the CEO of Salesforce, I can say that cloud computing is simply putting a better way to run your business. And everyone that has ever dealt with a cluster on premises know that the maintenance can be really a tedious and annoying issue. While cloud computing is the long-held dream of computing as a utility, so using a cloud provider, that in this case was chosen GCP, that is Google Cloud Platform, it is possible to rent computational power with a pay-as-you-go policy. The key concept of cloud computing is virtualization, by which I mean that is the possibility of create onto a physical hardware different virtual hardware that can, in which I can deploy different operating systems. And this is really useful in bioinformatics because we have different tools that runs on different operating systems, so in this way it is possible to have in the same place everything that you need. Moreover, cloud computing is like the gray man in this picture that allow to connect my laptop to all this power. The services that I need in order to create a cloud genomics are four. The first is data as a service, because each cloud genomics rely heavily on the huge amount of data in order to increase the biological data set. Then we need a software as a service layer that are the tools and the pipeline that I use to analyze that data. then I have the platform as a service that is all the, for example, storage environment that in Google Cloud is named Google Cloud Storage, and each file is put into a bucket. At all these services lie on the most important one, that is the virtualized resource, the infrastructure as a service that I just described. Let's have a look in which can be the revolution in research that cloud computing can afford. First, on the left, we can see which is a traditional approach that I can name bring data to researcher, where usually data are stored into a centralized repository where researcher access to them and download data onto your onto their laptop, onto their on-premises cluster, and then using their tools they are analyzing data. While using, on the other end, a cloud-centric approach, it's possible to change the paradigm, and so we can bring researchers to data in a way that it's possible to create an environment that comprises the data as well as the tools and the different pipelines for the analysis in all in one place. In this way, the researchers have not to download data. In this way, there is not a multiplication of data all over the world. Let's have a deeper look in which are the characteristics of my Genome Cloud. First, let's consider the first difference with on cluster on-premises. And if you can see in this graph, the computational power that a cluster can give you is flat, and is described by this dot line. While usually bioinformatics rely on a computational requirement that can change very, very much. So we need a platform that is scalable, and cloud can allow us to dynamically accomplish the requirement that I need. In this way, using this quote, software first, hardware last, I say that I can completely focus myself on developing software, and then I can create the hardware as well as I need. In this way, using a GitLab, that is a code repository source, I program which is the environment, and then I create it onto GCP, Google Cloud Platform. Second, I used a containerized approach using the well-known Docker container. Why this? Because, as I said before, bioinformatic pipelines are made of different processes, and each process rely on a different software. In this way, using Docker container, I can compact all the binaries and the dependencies that I need for that software in a way that makes this very portable, so I'm not linked to one provider, but if I change provider, I can take with me all the software. Secondly, it is easy to deploy on the virtualized resource, and moreover, it can increase data sharing because other group of researchers can launch the same analysis with the same software on me. Third and most important, parallel computing. Why parallel computing? Because when you can go faster, you have to go parallel. In this way, using Nextflow, that is a software developed by the University of Barcelona, I managed to orchestrate the entire process of the pipeline, creating different virtualized resources by which in which Nextflow managed the input of each of them, and finally, when the task is finished, Nextflow shut down the virtualized machine and collect the output result. Finally, I managed to give a I managed to create an environment that allowed me to have an only cloud infrastructure. In this way, as the sequencer finished to sequence the data is immediately sent into the cloud. And this is really important because genomic and biometric data are strictly controlled by GDPR. So an only cloud infrastructure allowed me to be completely GDPR compliant. Now, let's introduce you which has been my case study, and I had the challenging opportunity to test my just created environment to tackle SARS-CoV-2. In fact, using a transcriptomic approach that relies on taking the data, taking the epithelial of cell of a patient using a swab cotton test, it is possible at the same time to take also the viral RNA if it is present. And copy then into a cDNA, I can get it as an input for the sequencer. In this way, using my bioinformatic pipeline, after that I translate from a BCL to a FASTQ format the file, it is possible to run my analysis, that is split in two parts. The first part, each reads that map on human genome, are collected and onto that reads is performed gene expression in order to evaluate the pathogenicity correlated with the virus into the patient. On the other side, every reads that not map onto human genome is saved, and using Terra, that is a web-based platform developed by the Broad Institute, was possible to me to run to align that reads to the SARS-CoV-2 genome that was released by the Broad Institute, and then to give the output to another tool that is Nextstrain to evaluate the mutation of SARS-CoV-2 and the spatiotemporal changement of the virus. As a result, first I can describe which happens onto human, and this is the result of statistical analysis to evaluate the differential gene expression between a positive and a negative sample. And now we can see into the graph on your right, this is a hierarchical cluster in which each row is a gene, and the two columns represent negative and positive sample. And choosing, for example, one gene that is really differential expressive that we can appreciate from the bar plot, this gene is IFET1, that is a gene that produces a protein that is useful to contrast RNA, viral RNA replication. And we can see that this gene is also associated conducting a pathway analysis to two important pathways, like oxidative stress response and apoptosis signaling pathway. That means either of them, it means that is an inflammatory pathway that is happening to that tissue. Secondly, in this picture, that is an integrative genome viewer, we can see that into the blood, the blue line is the entire viral RNA of SARS-CoV-2, that its length is 29 kilobases, and we can see that, for example, into using a negative sample, each of these gray boxes represent a reads, and with the negative sample we have no mapping onto this genome, while in a positive sample we have a high coverage of the entire genome, and moreover, these two red lines represent a single nucleotide variation, a SNV, that can be further analyzed using Nextstrain. Nextstrain has sequenced and has shared more than 10,000 genomes, and what you see here is a phylogenetic tree that is useful to understand which has been the evolution of the virus, also not only from a spatio, but also in which are the main gene that is changing in that virus. We are still working on this because we want to analyze which has been the evolution in the virus in southern Italy, but we have to increase our data set because we need at least 1,000 genomes to be sequenced. Okay, in conclusion, during my internship, I managed to develop the necessary infrastructure on Google Cloud. More difficult I had to deal with the data transfer between the sequencer, the server and the cloud. I tested different workflow languages and I chose Nextflow as the orchestrator of my bioinformatic pipeline and for parallel computing. And most importantly, as an engineer, as I said, cloud computing is a pay-as-you-go policy, so I had to optimize the cost and resource based on my need. Okay, giving you some future perspective, I first think to an immediate and tackling the so-called phase 2 of pandemic, we need to to make better the way by which we do testing. Because nowadays, testing using swab is very rely on error-dependent, operator-dependent error-prone, and moreover, it is very, very time-consuming. While other type of tests, like serological tests, is not, it consists of a lot of false positive. So, like was discussed last month by Professor Netti during one of his conference, the development of smart biosensor can give a really an help in the fighting SARS-CoV-2. And I think that my work can give to that sensor the necessary target in order to understand if it's present or not SARS-CoV-2 virus. Moreover, as a future perspective that is more than one decade from me, I think that we have not to do the error to overestimate the effect of a technology in short run and underestimate the effect in the long run. Because I think that we are in an historical moment in which there are one wave from biotech field and the other wave from digital technology and IoT that can completely change the way by which we do healthcare today, and leading to a more and more personalized medicine. Thank you for your attention. If you have any question, I'm glad to answer it. Thank you.
Thank you, Marcello. It's extremely interesting piece of work, and ask colleagues from the Commission if there is any comment, suggestion, question. I will start something that I think that, as you mentioned, I also cited your work for being included in the smart biosensor. I would like to ask you if there is any chance that with your technology could also kind of separate presence of sequence of the RNA of the virus, if this is vital or not. In other words, you could check if there is a virus there, but the virus can be dead, and then it cannot infect if it's dead, right? But yes. If with this technology, you fragment the gene sequence. So basically, you don't know if this is a vital one or is not a vital one. Is any way that you can also recover the kind of viability of the virus, so the degree of infection of the viral charge?
I think that I described our pipeline using the sequencing not only the viral RNA but also the epithelial nasal cell from the host. It's possible to understand which is the pathogenicity. So maybe it's possible to correlate these two data, the one taken from the virus and the one taken from the human cell, and understand if the virus is its life, or it's the life, its virus is dead, it's not more inducing any pathogeny.
Okay. All right. If there is no other curiosity, I will again thank to Marcello for this wonderful presentation, and move on to the last. I candidati ci sono tutti?
Sì, professor.
Sì.
Allora, la discussione la completiamo in italiano a beneficio di amici, di tutti che possono essere raccolti intorno a voi in questo momento, che saluto con grande piacere, perché devo dire i ragazzi sono stati straordinari. In un periodo di lockdown, quindi con accesso ovviamente limitato ai laboratori, sono riusciti a fare dei lavori che sono assolutamente di pregio, abbiamo sentito tutti, l'intera professione si è congratulata con i lavori che si è riusciti a fare. Il modo di presentarvi è sicuramente brillante, è stata una bella mattinata, diciamo, di discussione molto intensa e molto molto interessante. Quindi congratulazioni davanti alla commissione e tutta sul vostro lavoro. Quindi avevamo deciso di chiudere il laboratorio. Sono scherzo. No, anzi, quindi siete riusciti in un momento veramente difficile per tutti, ma in particolare per voi, sappiamo tutti che durante la tesi il momento diventa sempre più agitato, però siete riusciti a cavarla in maniera eccellente. Quindi io do lettura adesso del cerimoniale della proclamazione della conseguente della laurea, dopodiché dirò qualche parola a nome anche della commissione su quello che sarà il vostro futuro e poi ci saluteremo e vi lasceremo ai vostri giusti festeggiamenti. Allora, per i poteri conferiti a magnifico direttore dell'Università degli Studi di Napoli, Federico II, a me delegati, dichiaro dottori in Industrial Engineering e ingegneri i seguenti studenti. Eugenio Margherita con voto di 110 su 110. Enza Cece con voto di 110 e lode su 110. Denis Pagliare con voto di 110 e lode. Giovanni Lento con voto di 110 e lode. Carmela Mariania con voto di 110 Mariani, scusate, Carmela Mariania Mariani con voto di 110 e lode. Viviano Marcuso con voto di 110 e lode. Marcello Salvi con voto di 110 su 110. Ricordare che noi siamo qui, non scappiamo, se avete bisogno di noi per qualunque denuncia, per qualunque discussione, per qualunque dubbio, per qualunque cosa vogliate poi chiedere oppure chiedete il nostro aiuto, siamo assolutamente a vostra disposizione. Sono convinto che non avete nessuna difficoltà, ragazzi di ginnasio, abbiamo avuto modo di conoscervi e quest'ultima fase della vostra carriera scolastica, diciamo, di apprendimento ha dimostrato quanto siete bravi, quindi io vi faccio i miei migliori auguri e rimango a vostra completa disposizione a nome di tutta la commissione per qualunque altra possibilità di interazione, che spero ci sia, spero che non ci abbandoniate, state sempre in contatto con noi, qualunque sia il vostro percorso. Quindi, ancora auguri e non vi trattengo ulteriormente da vostri giusti festeggiamenti.
Grazie.
Hmm?